Live from the Talking Joe Studios, it's Talking Joe.
Talking Joe weekly podcast. Talking Joe's there. Talking Joe thought we would last. Talking Joe is there. Find each other like a married couple. A podcast on the air. Talking Joe is there.
Talking Joe is the code name for a completely untrained special podcast force. Its purpose, to produce a regular comic review show while breaking and replacing a series of presenters from across the world.
Talking Joe. Talking Joe is there. Talking Joe. We are on our soapbox. Nobody seems to care. Fighting for fandom wherever there's trouble. The podcast on the air. Talking Joe is there. Talking Joe. Talking Joe.
Talking Joe is on the air.
Hey, 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 it's me, Mark, and welcome to Talking Joe, the best and longest running dedicated G.I. Joe comics podcast. Today we will be looking at G.I. Joe issue 279 with a very special guest, as well as our regular favourites. And now, without further ado, here's the Peter Cook to my Dudley Moore. It's my co-host, Tim. Tim, how are you, sir?
I'm well, Mark. How are you?
I'm fantastic. Thank you. The sun is shining. Things are open. It's amazing.
This is a tiny window. The issue of G.I. Joe that we're talking about today was released on Wednesday, and
exactly,
I got it yesterday, Friday, and we're recording on a Saturday.
It's all go. It's real time. Yeah, I mean, this show has been going the best part of over 2 years now, and you know, we started with issue one of ARAH, doing a few issues every single week, and we've got to the point now where we're in real time talking about a comic that came out a matter of days ago. So it is very, very cool to sort of be right in the present. And that brief delay of having between issue 278 and this one coming out felt like forever, because you know, I'm all up to date with my G.I. Joe. So looking forward to the latest issue coming out right to the minute. But yeah, let's not waffle on, Tim. We've got a special guest who is holding on and waiting to be introduced. So let's play that jingle.
All right, stop. Whatever you're doing, TJ's back, the airwaves were chewing, rocking a G.I. Joe podcast. Interview special, questions will be asked. Will it ever stop? Yo, I don't think so. Not as long as someone's publishing Joe. Artists, writers, G.I. Joe fanboys, let's get things started and hope we don't annoy our guest in the studio right now. They've come in for a chat discussing when, where and how. Probing, we're going in deep. Anything left, we might as well be asleep. Questioning them about the G.I. Joe history. Unwrapping answers like a whodunit mystery. TJ interview. TJ interview.
So who have we got on the show today? It is Alex Ironhed Sanchez. He's a comic artist based in NYC. He's recently been working on Pandemica for IDW. Previous work has included Battlestar Galactica for Dynamite, Katana and JSA Classified for DC Comics, Star Wars The Old Republic for Dark Horse. He's a co-host on the Infinity Equation podcast, a toy enthusiast, and has worked on toy projects of his own, including working with Jason Egitto on 1/6 toy projects, such as the Five Faces of Freddy Kruger set. But most importantly for us, he was the artist on G.I. Joe Special Missions Part 1, which covered a stalker spotlight, and the artist of the book we are talking about today, G.I. Joe 279, Untold Tales, Part 4. Oof. There we go. Welcome to the show, Alex.
Thanks for having me. How's everyone doing today?
Better now that you're here.
Aw, thanks. Thanks. Thanks for the compliments. And very well researched. You pulled out things that even I didn't remember.
Did I cover the major bases? Was there anything there in your plotted notes that we should be familiar with?
No, you pretty much covered it all. Although I am currently working on a 100-page graphic novel for Aftershock Comics. So I was actually started working on that and simultaneously working on the latest issue of G.I. Joe. So it was a hectic 2 months for me during that time period, to say the least.
Wow.
Who's the writer on the Aftershock graphic novel?
It's two writers, Steve Orlando and Steve Fox.
Cool.
Yeah, and I believe they're dabbling right now in some Marvel projects. Mm-hmm. Can't tell you which ones because I don't really collect comics and haven't since I was pretty much a teenager. I just, especially when I started working in the industry, you know, I spent like 12, 15 hours a day drawing comic books. The last thing I wanted to do was, you know, go to the local comic book store and, you know, see my huge pull list. So, once I started working in the industry, I kind of just delved into the art aspect of it and really didn't and stopped collecting comics, to be honest with you.
I have found with a few of my friends who draw for Marvel and DC and Image that they still go to the comic book store. Mine and they still buy some books, but not a ton. And they tend to sort of look through the books and enjoy them, but not necessarily read them, or not a lot of like month to month collecting.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
For the reasons you just said.
Yeah. And also, I mean, I collect a bunch of toys, you know, G.I. Joe figures, of course. And all my extra pocket money goes into that mostly. So, it's kind of like a break from the art thing, you know?
Yeah. Okay. Let's now you've raised it. Let's talk about the toys. So I saw an Instagram post from you, as I was doing my research that said, I think it said that you'd completed your collection of 25th anniversary G.I. Joe figures.
Yeah.
So sounds like you're deep into the collecting and including the modern stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I only really collect the modern Joes. Okay. I don't collect the 6-inch, the classified, just the 25th anniversary, just because I think they got so deep into that line. They pretty much covered every character, even after the line was discontinued and they just did the Collector's Club figures. I mean, that went on for years. So I don't think that you can really get any better than the 25th anniversary, for me anyways, just because I'm a cartoon accurate collector. Mm-hmm. And they had so many variations of the characters, whether, you know, you wanted to collect just like the vintage toy inspired 25th figures, or you wanted to collect the comic book inspired figures, or the cartoon. I like the cartoon accurate ones. So the new classifieds, they look cool. They're bigger scale, but they don't remind me of the cartoons. And that's my nostalgia hook, you know?
Uh-huh. Okay. And is it the cartoons above the comic as well, the G.I. Joe comic?
Yeah. Absolutely. Just because I literally got into G.I. Joe in 1982. I think it was the end of 82 when the cartoon launched. So that was in my consciousness before I even got into comics. I think I got into comics maybe like 2 or 3 years later.
Wow. Okay. And did you pick up the G.I. Joe comic book and reading that in parallel?
Oh, I had them all. I had the entire collection up until my mom threw away all my comics because she didn't know any better.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. I was like, Mom, what are you doing? They're in bags and boards. Like,
oh no,
that means I want to keep them. She's like, oh, I didn't know. So I had to start over from scratch, but I didn't start over on the Joe line, on the Joe comics. Kind of just stuck to Uncanny X-Men and Daredevil.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, there's a lot of that to collect, isn't there?
Oh, yeah. I still have them. Like, those comics that I had as a child after the first batch was thrown away, I still have them. And I collected a lot of comics for, you know, many years afterwards. And then about 10, 12 years ago, I was looking at all my bins and I was like, okay, I don't plan on reading any of these, you know, because I had like doubles, triples, you know, it was during the 90s when everyone's buying, you know, you thought you could pay off your mortgage, you know, reselling your comics. You bought doubles and you bought triples and then you bought a bunch of stuff that you weren't really interested in, but I guess because of the hype or whatever.
Particularly so, a hologram on it or whatever.
Yeah, it was a holochrome, you know, cover or whatever, gold foil, back forth, you know, wrap around. I got rid of all that stuff. I trimmed the fat. I had about, I'd say about 10, 12,000 comics, and I'm down to like 3,000, and they're just the books that I know I'm going to read, you know, in my golden years. Not that I haven't read a bunch of them already, but that's going to be part of my retirement plan.
Alex, where did you buy your comics?
We had a few local shops here in New York City. The first comic book store that I can remember going to was called Big Apple Comics. No, West Side Comics, which was on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. And then there, Big Apple Comics, which was in, also on the Upper West Side. And then there was another one called Funny Business Comics, which I got some local press because I guess the guy, the owner, this older gentleman, was like sold like one of like the highest, you know, most valuable comics at that time. I can't remember what the issue was, but he made news and I was like, oh yeah, that's my local comic book store. But all those guys are gone. And the only thing that's left now is Midtown Comics, really.
Were you buying comics off of any newsstands or?
Oh my God! That was before I even knew what a comic book store was. That's how I actually started collecting. Well, when I was in school, I traded some toys for a stack of comics. I didn't know what they were, and I got hooked. And prior to me even knowing what a comic book store was, we used to go to the newsstand and get them off the racks, the spin racks, the magazine stores, all that. I mean, I can remember there's a great issue of Daredevil written by a lady called Annie Nesenti, which she's my favorite writer of all time. She's the one that created the Typhoid Mary character in Daredevil. Yeah. I don't know if you remember. Yeah. And thankfully I was able to work with her on Katana for DC Comics back in like 2010 or something, which is a great highlight. But she wrote this issue where all of Daredevil's villains get together and just beat the hell out of them, and they left them for dead. It was like a double-sized issue, and I remember this is pre-comic book store, so I was waiting for the next issue to come out on the newsstands, and it didn't come out for like a good 3 months because at that time it's like not like newsstands were on schedule every month. You know, there were times where you could go a couple of months and miss an issue and not even realize it because, you know, you're just a kid or whatever. So I remember waiting about 3 months for this next issue to come out. I thought the series was over because they literally left him for dead. And then 3 months later, I see it on the newsstand and I yelled so hard. I was so loud that I scared about a group of people right next to me. They were like, oh, what's wrong? I was like, oh my God, this comic book, nothing, leave me alone. So yeah, I do remember the spin racks and newsstands and all that stuff. Those days, I wish, man, I don't know what happened, but I mean, I do know what happened, but I just wish those times would come around again, but doubt it.
Can you paint a picture for our listeners of what life is like at the Joe Kubert School?
Oh, it's great. It's amazing. It's like you're surrounded by a bunch of people who love art and comics and these characters as much as you do. And they also love all the other stuff that's, you know, because when you talk about comic books, you talk about toys, you talk about video games, you talk about, you know, this, that, and the other. And just imagine being like in a really small college campus. You know, I think the first year I was at the Kubert School, we had 200 students in the entire school, and you lived in, basically we used to call it the frat house because it's just like this big house that used to be the school itself, but they grew, so they moved the school facilities to a I think it was a high school, yeah, and they used the old facilities, which was this big mansion, as like dormitory for the first year students. So that first year of the Kubert School, it's just like you wake up, you know, 8 o'clock, go to class 8:30, and like all your classes, you have two classes each day and 3 hours long, break in between. And it's just like, you're just engulfed in art, the technique, you know, the techniques of art, the, sharpening your skills, learning storytelling, learning, lettering, which is, you know, everyone does it on the computer now, but back then lettering was actually an art within itself, because you can put as much of your personality in lettering as you can in, you know, drawing a character. So, and then there was also an animation department, which was very small. There was only a handful of students that decided to go that route, you know, as opposed to doing the comic book thing. But you were taught by great artists who were experienced in the field, like Alex Stevens, who worked for DC, Vertigo, different kinds of artists. Fernando Ruiz was our first year narrative, which is the narrative class, which is, it's like your core class. Like, that's the one where you actually draw comic book pages and you're taught the art of storytelling. Our instructor the first year was a gentleman by the name of Fernando Ruiz, who drew Archie comics for years and years and years. And he was one of the best instructors I've ever had. And mind you, I went to regular college. And what I mean regular college is like where you get your BA, you know. I studied architectural design for 3 years, and then I switched over to fine arts, and I ended up getting my BA in fine arts. And Fernando Ruiz was one of the best instructors that I ever had, because he was so giving and open to giving you your advice that you saw, I learned so much of my technique from the things that he taught us in that class. So just a bunch of great students, great teachers, and then you have Joe Kubert there, who, you know, is a comic book legend, kind of overseeing things. And if you were disciplined enough to make it to the third year, which is the final year, you were taught by Joe Kubert narrative. Wow. And that was a whole other treat within itself.
Wow. So what years were you at the school?
2000 to 2003, four-ish, because we start in fall 2000. Mm-hmm. And then we were done in May of 2004.
Can you talk about finishing, and how does the school, how did, specifically for you, how did the school set you up with interviews, or do you just start talking to editors, go to conventions?
Yeah, it's kind of a little bit of everything. The way that the school prepared us is really, a lot of it has to do with just repetition and consistency, because a lot of people don't realize that one of the toughest parts, if not the toughest part, of drawing comics is just sitting down and doing it. I mean, it's very easy to get distracted. You have to focus on a piece of paper for a very long time, so it's not unnatural to hear a comic book artist say, you know, I spent 8-10 hours straight, you know, just drawing one comic book page. You kind of have to figure out how long does it take you to finish one page, and whether you're penciling and inking it or you're just penciling it, you have to create a schedule based on that. And the school taught us how to do that. They taught us how to use mixed media, how to use things that aren't just pencils, you know, paints, acrylic paints, oil paints, the computer. I was in school during a time when there was a transition from the old way of things, the way things were done, to the way things are done now. And what I mean by that is just when I started out, we used to send our original pages via FedEx, you know, via couriers. And now everything, you know, is scanned and sent to the computer. So when I graduated, the computer took a hold of the industry, and it's where it is now because of it. I'm sorry, what was the second part of your question?
Did you have work waiting for you as you graduated?
Okay, yeah. So another thing that the school did is they encouraged us. They didn't take us, but they encouraged us to go to conventions. So I would get together. This is another thing, great thing about the school, is like I could tell 10, 20 guys, hey guys, you know, you want to go to this convention? You know, it's in Atlanta or Georgia, you know, or it's in Texas or it's in North Carolina or wherever, Philly, wherever. You guys want to go? Yeah. You know, get three cars and we all head out there with our portfolios in hand. And this is during a time when you can go to a convention, show your portfolio to an editor that is actually there at the publisher's booth, and he can give you a job right there on the spot. So I did that for about 2-3 years, and on one trip to Wizard World Philadelphia, I met an editor from Dark Horse, and he liked my work, and he was like, here's my card, give me a call when you get back home. And I called him. By the time I was about to graduate from the school, I was already drawing my first pro gig.
Oh, and what was that?
It was Buffy the Vampire Slayer spin-off series called Tales of the Vampires, and I did a story called The Framing Story, which is basically the bookend story of each issue. So each issue, which consisted of 22 pages, I did 4 of the 22 pages, which were the bookends, and eventually got collected into the graphic novel, and it was written by Joss Whedon, who I'm sure everybody knows who that is. So yeah, that was my first gig.
Very cool. Yeah, I mean, it was quite a big book at the time, because it was a Buffy spin-off, which was obviously huge at the time, and being written by the showrunner himself, you know, as a comic, compared to most licensed properties being, you know, handed off to other creators, was quite a coup.
Yeah, and whenever I go to, I mean, I rarely go to conventions. I really only go to the big New York Comic Con here anymore. And I'm not a big convention guy. Like I said, I like to stay home and draw majority of the time. But whenever I do conventions, the Buffy book is always still, you know, however, 18 years later, you know, one of the books that people come up and ask me to sign to this day. So,
Alex, how did you get in? How did you get on an editor's radar to draw G.I. Joe?
Oh, God, I think, well, Tom Waltz is the editor over there at IDW for G.I. Joe. And I've been working, doing projects for him for years now. And even before he was on G.I. Joe, I believe. So when he moved over to G.I. Joe, and I was still, you know, in contact with him, it just kind of lined up that way.
So yeah, let's talk about a bit more about how 251 happened. I guess was as a G.I. Joe fan, was it kind of a thing on your bucket list that you absolutely wanted to have a chance at drawing an issue of G.I. Joe eventually?
Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Anytime I get the opportunity to work on one of those, you know, vintage 80s IPs like the G.I. Joes and like the Transformers or anything like that, I will find a way to squeeze it in. Like I mentioned before, I'm working on a 100-page graphic novel, but that didn't stop me from saying, yeah, I want to draw this issue of G.I. Joe. So yeah, it's definitely was, still is even, you know, I'd love to do more G.I. Joe stuff. Definitely on my pro bucket list.
Yeah. And what I noticed was that for 251 and 279, you've drawn gatefold covers.
Yeah, that was those were both my idea.
Yeah, I was gonna ask, was that something they asked for or just something
No, it's just something that I was like, hey, you know, let me do a double. Yeah. Well, that's because I had a good enough relationship with my editor Tom to be able to even bring that up, you know. Normally I wouldn't be that pushy. Maybe I would actually, but with Tom more so, because I know that Tom wants to put out the best comic book out there, so for G.I. Joe, because he himself is also a big fan too, which is not rare. But when you can find an editor that is a fan of the stuff that he's editing, then that's always a plus.
Absolutely, yeah,
it just makes it easier to work with, because you already have like that mutual ground, that mutual fandom ground, you know, to bounce ideas off of.
And as cool as the cover to 251 was, I remember at the time thinking, you know, Stalker's there, but it would with those guys chasing him on the river, and he's coming off, and it looks like it's maybe, you know, they're Viet Cong, possibly. So, you know, it's kind of set up a little bit like that, and I thought, you know, it would be, you know, it would have pinged maybe a little bit more if it was a all out Cobra you know, attack scene. And then I saw on your social media the rough draft of it, and I was blown away. I was like, wow.
Yeah, that was that. What happened there is, the covers always get. We always get our cover projects, even if we're, you know, if we're doing the interiors, we always get the covers in advance of the interior script. So I think it's because the way Larry Hama works is he's like has an idea and he just puts it down, and then he moves on to the next issue, and he, you know, so he's like planting little seeds of ideas with these issues, and I think he works so far in advance sometimes. Or at least he plots things so far in advance sometimes that when they gave me the cover assignment, they were like, okay, just put a stalker looking like a badass, and that's all. That's literally all the description, the entire description that he gave me. Just draw stalker looking like a badass, something like that. I'm paraphrasing. And I did that. I drew the pencils. I was like, man, I want to cram in all the things that I want to draw about G.I. Joe. So I put in, the moccasin. I put in the pterodrome in the background. I think I put some Cobra soldiers in there. Maybe I put some fire bats. Yeah. I can't remember, but it was completely filled with like Cobra versus Stalker. And Stalker had a look of like, just tired, being tired. And when I sent the pencils in, they were like, this is great. So I think I waited like about a month to get the script. And when I got the script, my editor was like, "Oh, I'm CCing Larry, and he has some things to talk to you about." And Larry's like, "Okay, the story is actually about like Stalker and like the Vietnamese, and we're gonna need you to change all that background stuff, and I need you to change Stalker's expression." I was like, oh, okay, no big deal. I mean, you get asked to do revisions. Sometimes you get asked to do revisions a lot. Sometimes you don't get asked to do revisions at all. You know, it's just like a mixed bag sometimes. And I'm not going to argue with Larry Hama. You know, the guy, if anyone knows G.I. Joe, a real American hero, Larry Hama does. So I was like, okay, cool. But so I changed it, and it's like a flashback to, I guess, a flashback amalgamation of like, because Stalker's in his current Joe fatigues, but it's kind of taking place back in, like during the Vietnam era. So I had to take all the Cobra guys, take out the Pterodrome, which was fine, but the part that kind of irked me a little bit, and when I say irked, I don't mean like, damn you, Larry or Tom, you know. It's just whenever you change the expression of something that you've already drawn, you kind of lose like an emotional layer to it. So I wish I would have been able to have kept. And the reason that he said that I should change Stalker's expression is because he says Stalker never shows any emotion whatsoever. So it made sense. I changed it. He's got more of a blank expression. He's kind of looking back behind him to see what's going on. He hears the noise of the Viet Cong in the boat. And I changed. Also, Stalker had the jetpack, the G.I. Joe jetpack.
Jump.
Yeah, and which I was telling a story with that because the jetpack was destroyed, which means, you know, he was getting shot at. He got hit in the jetpack. He's grazed on the arm. And Larry's like, nope, got to get rid of that because, you know, there weren't no jetpacks. So those kinds of little revisions, if you guys, I think I also have the finished cover posted up there. For anyone that's listening to kind of see and compare. So yeah, those were the revisions I had to do. I wish I could have. What I should have done is I should have made copies of those pencils at a high res, so that way I could just ink it on my own and like maybe like sell it out as a print or something. Because I think I actually like it more than the cover that was published, but it just doesn't really connect to the story inside, so I understand why the changes had to be made.
Sure. But yeah, a shame, but can understand the thinking behind it. And I guess as a huge G.I. Joe fan, the story itself was mostly the G.I. Joe's kind of in mufti fighting against terrorists again. So You know, you didn't necessarily get to scratch the full G.I. Joe itch in terms of showing them all in their costumes against all the cobras and stuff.
Yeah, that's why I like my favorite pages in that issue are the first few pages, because you actually, I think you see Stalker in his normal fatigues, and everybody else is pretty much in, like, you know, civilian wear, from what I remember.
Yeah. They're kind of like on an undercover mission for most
of them. Yeah, so they're in a hotel or something like that. Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, this was like, I think this was like 5 years ago already.
Oh, crikey. it feels very recent to me because it wasn't that long ago that we were talking about it on the podcast. Yeah, I guess, let's see, what was the cover date for this? It's April 2018.
Oh, okay, so not that long ago, 3 years ago.
Although he had probably drawn sometime before that as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How, Alex, how hard were you lobbying to come back and draw another issue? How much of that was your schedule? How much of that was your lobbying or Tom Waltz's encouragement?
This is right when COVID. So he had, I think I was in between projects and I was just like looking for something to do. And I hit him up the end of the year prior, if I remember correctly. And he's like, yeah, I'll get you something on G.I. Joe. And like months pass. And and I think it's right when COVID hit. My time frame is kind of wonky because so much has happened in between then. But I think I ended up waiting like a good 2 months or so for Larry to finish the script, and it was during the time when like COVID was like starting or it was affecting the comic book industry. So I kept hitting him up. I was like, hey man, are we still what's going on with G.I. Joe? Because I was about to start this 100 page graphic novel, so I didn't want them to cross over, which they eventually did. And you know, that's why I had to just like buckle down and just like get it done, and all nighters and all that stuff I used to do when I was back at the Kubert school. So I don't think I've lobbied super hard because, again, I have a rapport with Tom, and it's not like I I've done a lot of stuff for IDW, so they know me there. I've done miniseries, I've done one shots, I've done covers, so they know me there, and they are very gracious at giving me work. So I don't think either of us had to lobby too hard.
Interesting. Yeah, I noticed actually that you posted the front cover to 279 on your social medias back in June 2020. So it's obviously been a project that's long time gestating between those first conversations and actually it hitting the racks.
And especially hitting the racks. I think it was delayed about 2-3 months, maybe something like that. Originally, I think they told me that it was going to come out March, like the first week of March, and then it changed into the first week of April, and I think it just came out last Tuesday or so, the 10th.
Okay, Tim, have you got the paper issue in front of you? What does it say on the inside front cover for the date?
January 2021.
January.
Alex, when you get work, when you are offering your services to editors, you are only a penciler and inker together, correct? You're not trying to get work these days as just a penciler?
Right. Yeah, that's one thing that they taught us at the Kubert School is that there's never anyone that can ink you better than you. So from the get-go, I always presented myself as like an all-in-one package. So I would say that 95% of the work that I've done, I've inked myself. I can't even remember the last time. And when I wasn't inking myself, my pencils are so tight that they can just digitally ink them, which I don't like because I think it kind of ends up looking a little bit muddy. A little bit gray, but even when I wasn't inking myself, I kind of was because they were going off my pencils.
A standard 20-page issue, right? It's hard to know how long this issue took you to draw because it was during another project, but how long will it take you sort of in a normal scenario to pencil and ink 20 pages for a single issue?
Normal scenario, it takes me, I've got it down to about 8 hours now
per
page. Yeah. Yeah. So 20 times, you know, you do the math.
Right. So you can do a monthly book, but it sounds like.
Yeah. Oh no, I can definitely do a monthly book. It takes me about 6 weeks to complete an entire 20 page issue with cover. So yeah, I mean, I came from the era where doing monthlies were like the norm, you know. Like nowadays, it's tough to get to do more than six issues in a row, you know. But that's one of the big pro bucket list things left for me to do, is to stay on a book for a good amount of time. I'd say about a year, get 12 issues done. But you're finding editors less and less that are willing to do that, because they like splitting it up. Because when you split things up, even a penciler and an inker, when you split those two up, it's one, you know, if something goes wrong, it's not all falling on one guy. You know, it's easier to dig yourself out of a hole when you've got somebody else helping you out, you know, i.e. inker.
Yeah. I think in the modern era, since there are seemingly less artists who can do monthly, or fewer editors who want to go that route. And some of it is also sort of taste. I think some editors want a book to be different every six issues, as if the readers are going to get bored.
Right, right.
And I think readers don't get bored. I think readers want consistency, and readers want definitive runs, even if it's, you know, 2 years, not 5 or 6 years. But I feel like sort of the modern, like Marvel, DC sweet spot might be one artist does 4 or 5 or 6 issues, another artist does 4 or 5 or 6 issues, and then that first artist comes back and does 4 or 5 or 6 issues. And I feel like sort of the ABA of that is actually as far as it goes now. And then by then, it's like, well, the guy who drew the first 6 issues and then came back to do like 11 and 12, it's like, well, we're gonna put him on like a new series. He's gonna launch a new series. Like Marvel definitely has quote A artists who will launch a series. I mean, how many Marvel series can we look back at from the last 10 years where one of those artists who's a household name for comics draws the first 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 issues, and then by issue 20, someone who's very talented but not a name is doing that series, and then by issue 40 or 50, it's like, well, time to launch this with a new number one.
And it's really funny to hear, like, you're spot on. It is editor's taste as well, but it's funny to like talk about, like, you know, oh, 6 issues in a row, you know, it's like such a, you pat yourself on the back for that. But it's like, I mean, if you just go back to the 80s, to the 70s, six, and everyone before that, it's like they could do 6 issues standing on their head, sitting on the toilet. You know, it's like they used to, I mean, I'm like John Romita Jr. I love John Romita Jr. because every month I knew I was going to get his X-Men or Daredevil issue every single month. And I think he did it for like a good 2, 3, 4 years each book. You know, it's like I wish that time would come around again where they would just give artists more responsibility. But then again, it's like the pedigree of artists is so different nowadays. It's like I don't even know if like artists are interested in staying on a book more than 6 issues, more than like a story arc.
And also many artists draw more detail, right? It's like, Kirby was doing 4 books a month at Marvel in the 60s, but he was also penciling more loosely, and the inkers were doing a lot of the drawing. And a lot of pencilers in the last 20 years, either by choice, because they don't sort of trust whoever the inker might be, or by sort of training, it's like, no, I want to make this super tight. Pencils are now so tight that inkers are doing some of the drawing, but you know, there may not be as much of a, you know, like when John Buscema was drawing Conan, right? It's like that book looks wildly different depending on who's inking, because they're not inking, quote, finishing.
And I
can't imagine a lot of editors wanting that right now. It's like, you can draw X-Men, but your pencils can sort of be half of what they were when you were drawing super tight on that other book last year.
Yeah, yeah. Another thing is that I think artists have kind of, well, you know, when I decided that I really wanted to become a comic book artist was like the late 80s, early 90s, during a time when the artist was the superstar of the book. Mm. You know, the Jim Lees, the whole Image group, you know, the Liefelds and the Silvestri. And now it's totally the writer is the star of the book. And I don't know what kind of effect that has had on the industry overall, because the comic books are a visual medium. First and foremost, I mean, yes, the characters are the real celebrities of the books, and fans will always follow those characters no matter who's writing or drawing them, you know, depending on the quality. But I feel like now, like, the artist has taken a back seat to the writer, and I don't know if that's a good thing, because we are a visual medium. Because if you take our artwork away from the book, I mean, it's, you can go to Barnes and Noble and buy those kinds of books, you know.
Can you so Larry Hama is known as a writer, but
he's also an artist.
Yes, he broke into comics, drawing comics. Mm-hmm. And can you differentiate drawing a Larry Hama script now that you've done it twice?
Yeah,
from
for
other
sure.
comic scripts that you have worked on?
Yeah, absolutely. Larry, when he writes a script, he puts in like little tidbits in between page text, and it's like super detailed stuff that only someone that has experience like dealing with like war basically would know. So he'll say things like, he'll be really specific about how a gun reloads, or the way a military figure salute someone or acknowledges someone, their posture, little things like that, that you, when you read it, you're like, yeah, this guy's been in service, you know. And I've worked on other books where it was military based and heavy technological stuff, and they treat it more, they kind of glaze over like those kinds of details, whereas Larry really lets you know, lets the artist know, okay, this is why this character is doing this in this particular way, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, yes, it does.
Yeah, and I think particularly on this issue, the 279, there's a lot of technical detail to get yeah. right and get across. The mind boggles at the process, to be honest. Can we talk a bit about your art sort of technique and the process? So you sort of shared across with a couple of us, with a couple of pages with us, mm-hmm. and the pages are striking in terms of they look different to most, I guess, comic art pages that we typically see, because there's a lot of almost sort of black and white painting going, sort of grayscale mm-hmm. painting going on, and I'm not too sure what you're using, but there's a lot of gray tones and whiteout being employed here for technique, and just the precision of the art makes me wonder as well whether you've been ping-ponging between digital and analog techniques there as you're progressing the page. So yeah, maybe if you could talk about a little bit about the process that you would typically use in this unique look to your finished page.
Yeah, there's no digital work going on there at all. It's all, you know, on paper. So I said that I was working in a 100-page graphic novel, and I decided mm-hmm. to take this G.I. Joe issue on. I also decided that I want to work on more than double size pages. So these pages are, I think they're about somewhere in the range of like 22 by 34, something like that. They're huge. And the reason I did them at that size is because I wanted to be able to apply those techniques you just mentioned, Mark. For example, I was able to use airbrush, acrylic paint, all in grayscale, colored pencils, regular pencils, you know, ink washes, that kind of thing that you wouldn't be able, or you wouldn't be able to so much if they were standard, you know, 11 by 17 comic book artboard. So the reason I wanted to do this is because another thing, I'm all about crossing off stuff on my pro bucket list. Another bucket list thing for me was doing a grayscaled issue. Like one of my heroes, Travis Charest, he did a book in the late 90s, which was an X-Men Wildcats crossover.
Oh, yes.
And it was,
yeah.
And it was a world, it took place in World War II, and it was all grayscale. So I was like, I want to do that for G.I. Joe. So so that's what basically why those techniques that you see on the pages that I sent you.
Okay, brilliant. Yeah, I wondered whether just, you know, there's, particularly on this issue, because there's so much sort of technical detail in the, in the, the planes and all of this kind of thing, whether you'd done some of that layout digitally and then sort of gone back over it in the traditional you know, inks and things, but yeah, no, it's all blank page starting from scratch.
Correct. Yeah, it's all blank page. And kudos to Tom Waltz and the guys at IDW and the guys and girls at IDW for allowing me to do that. Really, I mean, because people don't really do that often anymore, which is sad.
I'm going to ask a question that's kind of a statement. Drawing G.I. Joe, a real American hero, is difficult. And I think sometimes I think people are sort of uncomfortable with or forget to acknowledge expertise, right? Like, you know, when someone's like, oh man, this looks so good. How did you do that? And the answer is sort of this modest, like, well, I'm very good at what I do, and I've been doing it for a long time, and I went to school for it, and I'm a professional, and I work very hard. So this is sort of half a question and half a statement, but because G.I. Joe has all this specificity, right? Like, you don't just have to draw one jet correctly in this issue. You have to draw five. And then on top of it, it's this aerial combat, and you have to keep track of where characters, I mean, planes, are, and all these different characters, and you know how many missiles. So this is a statement and a question, specifically G.I. Joe or Real American Hero, as opposed to say an issue of Star Wars or an Aftershock graphic novel. G.I. Joe is a hard book to draw.
Yeah, because there's so much technology on the page. You know, you have the USS flag, you have all these planes, and you know, and all these characters wearing this techie armor. It's like, you got to pull out your straight edge a lot more often than you would if you were like, you know, if it was like two Jedi fighting in the middle of like a canyon or something like that, you know? So you have a lot more freedom because the surrounding area and the objects near to close to them don't require two lines to meet perfectly, if that makes any sense. You know what I mean? So whenever I draw G.I. Joe, I can rest assured that I'm going to have to draw a lot of buildings, which require me to pull out my triangles or my T-squares. And so in that sense, it does take more time, at least more patience and more focus. But on top of that, G.I. Joe, you're dealing with a bunch of characters on the page at, you know, all at the same time. So you factor that in as well. It's like these pages are going to take a little bit longer than it would the others.
But it pays off. The issue, the black and white art of this issue looks so good, and the storytelling is great.
Thank you.
And we probably should transition to talk about the issue, Mark, because I have my one sentence sort of top line response to this. I'm eager to say it. So do you want to? Should we talk about the covers and the plot and the?
Sure. Yeah. The reason that I thought that some digital sort of technology must have been employed, because the detail on these jets, and you know the number of times that they're employed, you know, it's every page has got you know several vehicles, very detailedly you know conveyed. I thought to myself, it would be nuts to do this completely conventionally on a blank.
No.
Page.
Well, I'm a little crazy, I guess. No, but I love drawing traditional because you have the original pages, you know, to do with what you want, you know, whether you want to sell them, whether you want to stick them in your flat file and keep them forever, you at least you have them. So, I mean, for example, I'm going to Joe Fest. I'm going to be a featured artist at Joe Fest this year in Atlanta, Georgia. And I'm going to take those pages with me because I know there are G.I. Joe fans there that might be interested in them. So It's to my benefit to draw on paper. I mean, I can see why most artists actually prefer to work digitally because of the ease. You know, you don't have to deal with mixing paints or applying ink, or it's not as messy. But you lose those original pages. I mean, that's big for me. I guess it's just the time where I came from and the way I was taught.
If someone wants to get their hands on this original art, is the best place to find you at Joe Fest?
Joe Fest on my email or Instagram.
Do you have, Alex, a rough idea of how much pages might, what your asking price for pages for this issue might be?
Yeah, well, since they're almost triple size, I'm going to be asking north of $400 per page. Mm-hmm. And that's being very gracious, because normally my regular size pages go for about $400. So, it all depends. I mean, there are times when I've been to a convention and I've had like a stack of pages, and I've had an art dealer come up to me and say, "Hey, you don't want to carry all this stuff back. I'll give you this much." I'm like, "Okay."
Very kind of them.
Yeah.
Cool. Let's get dug into this issue proper. So we are talking G.I. Joe issue 279, released April 2021. That was last week. We have got the layout of the creative team: writer Larry Hammer, artist Alex Sanchez, colors Jay Brown, letters Neil Yutake, senior editor Tom Waltz, editor Megan Brown, and research assistant Diana Davis.
Let's have a look at the covers in the gallery.
So cover A is that double gatefold, both front and back cover, this sensational action sequence of a pterodrome exploding as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 G.I. Joe jets fly away. Yeah, Alex, do you want to tell us about it?
Oh, man, it was such a long time ago. All I know is Tom Waltz, my editor, was like, "Okay, we need the pterodrome with these three planes and these two characters inside two of the three planes to be visible." So it was originally supposed to be just a regular cover. I was like, "We've got too much stuff to cram in here. Can I make it a wraparound?" It's like, "Sure." So I made it a wraparound and just went to town on it. Had fun. One of the most enjoyable times I have had drawing a cover, just because I was like literally pulling out my toys, using them as reference for some of the shots, and like drawing it on paper. So penciled and inked myself, and yeah.
And suddenly this does not look like the interior art. There aren't gray washes. I don't see graphic markers. I don't see whiteout. The texturing and the detail in the backgrounds is different.
More traditional. Yeah. Yeah, that's a decision. I decided to do the grayscale stuff after I had already done the cover, because there was such a gap in between the time I got the cover assignment to the time that I received the script. So in between that time, I was like, "Hey, maybe I was like looking at like that issue of Wildcats that I mentioned earlier," and I was like, "Hey, I've always wanted to do this."
There's a subtle thing happening here. In Transformers comics, I don't know if it's like a Hasbro directive or an IDW directive, or if the artists just decide it's easier, but artists aren't drawing Autobot and Decepticon sigils. The colorists are applying them, and that's so that they can put them in perspective, and it's easier, right? It's just like a thing you can do in Photoshop. There's a Cobra symbol, a giant one, on this pterodrome, and it's not perfect, but it's drawn. And I like that because it agrees with the art. And I don't begrudge any artist in comics who, you know, just lets the colorist lay in the Cobra symbol, for example, because that does save some time. And maybe Hasbro likes it more because they know it'll look perfect. But I always find it a little distracting because it doesn't quite agree with the art.
Yeah, it looks like it's kind of layered on top unnaturally in some ways. Yes, I mean, that's not so much, like, I never received a directive from Hasbro or my editor saying, don't draw, you know, the Cobra symbol. It's more, I think it's more of just like the editor having faith in the artist that he can do that. So I've always, I mean, this goes back to what I said about going into the art Kubert school. They taught us lettering, and this is kind of like, logoing is kind of like lettering in a way, you know? So anytime I get the opportunity to do symbols or logos or even my own lettering, because a lot of my, at least a couple times in most of the books that I've worked on, I've always incorporated lettering, whether that be a sound effect as part of the background. It becomes part of the art for me. So Tom knows that I can do that kind of stuff and like to do that stuff. So that's what happened. And by the way, guys, I haven't even received my comp copies of this issue yet. So you what? Guys have it before I do.
Oh,
yeah.
Geez.
Yeah. I think it's because for some reason, the first time I worked for IDW, I think like back in like 2005 or six, I think it was when I worked on 30 Days of Night, I was still living at my mom's. So I think they still send all my comp issues to my mom's house, which is great because it gives me a reason to go and visit her again. But I still don't have it in hand.
I feel a little bad that Mark and I are just going on and on. I've got the stack of G.I. Joe copies in front of me.
Yeah,
I'm actually sitting clothed in a bathtub, and there are actually 80 copies of this issue up to my neck.
That's nothing. I've built a little vault full of them. I've just dived into them and just swimming.
Mark, can you tell us about position. Cover B and the retailer?
Yeah, so Cover B is by, I think this is probably pronounced Fico Osio, and again, it's aerial combat. We've got, I think this is the Sky Striker in the front.
Yes,
with. Is it Night Raven is the big black one coming up behind him, and then a Rattler in the distance. And it looks like maybe Manhattan scenescape in the far distance behind that, that they're above, or at least some sort of cityscape with some high towers. Quite a lot of muted sort of pale colors here, which means that then the planes themselves sort of pop a little bit more. But interesting, very kinetic.
So this is, I don't know if this is the first time that Osio has colored himself, but this is the first time I've seen it. And he's best known in IDW land for drawing Revolution, which was the Hasbroverse miniseries crossover where all the other Hasbro properties that had sort of quickly been introduced into the Transformers continuity met and fought. And his work is detailed and beautiful, and he can pull off drawing very small things next to very big things like a person and a Transformer. And at the time I was excited that IDW hired he draws in, and I mean this as a compliment, he draws in a hot style, right? Things are very, it feels very modern to, you know, Marvel and DC of the last 20 years, slick and dynamic. And I remember thinking how exciting for IDW that they've got this artist who's putting all this detail and can balance all of these different characters in this miniseries. At the same time, I thought, as I often do, I want this guy to draw the regular G.I. Joe book. So here he is drawing a cover. It's very exciting, and it's cool to see him color himself.
And then cover C is John Royal with Ace in his cockpit, pursued by Rattlers, and somewhat of a throwback to the classic issue 34 Shakedown from Mike Zeck, which was similarly themed with Ace and the Sky Striker in the foreground with a Rattler looming large behind him. Thoughts on this one, Tim?
So this one's inked by Jagdish Kumar, and it's colored by James O'Frady. This is... I like this drawing. Considering how dynamic and sort of fast a lot of John Royal's covers feel, this one feels slower, and I think he's balancing this portrait of Ace, right? Like, the more this becomes a close-up of someone's face, the less room there is to include something of his own jet and the jets that are chasing. But even in sort of the angles of the Rattlers, sort of how the missiles are being fired and the cannons, I do like this cover. It's not the most action-packed and dynamic of Royal's cover run. I love the colors. I always love what O'Frady does on Royal. And I would love it if O'Frady colored more G.I. Joe. What's most interesting to me here is comparing the three covers. Because we have a lot of months where the three or four covers or the two covers are quite different from each other. One of them does reflect the interior story, and then another one is some other character in some other scenario. And I may like those drawings. I don't really like those covers. I think covers should absolutely reflect the inside. But here we sort of, in a very general phrase, we have the same idea for three covers, you know, like aerial, action, make sure we can see the Sky Striker, make sure we can see Ace, and then what changes are some of the angles, color temperature, how sort of loud it is, and the specificity of the background. So with Alex's cover, right, it's like, that's the pterodrome, even if we don't quite know where it is. And with Osseo's cover, like, we think that's Manhattan with some forced perspective. And with Royal's, the land and the sea below us are not specific, which I think is totally okay, but it is one less piece of information that he's choosing to include. I appreciate that we get a close-up here because, you know, there are little things in Ace's costume which make him Ace, right? There's little tubing on his costume and the red details, right? And if you don't see that, it could sort of be any pilot. And so whenever we see a Joe character, you know, partly out of costume or in a costume that's sort of a more common type, I'm looking for those, you know, specific little cues that say, this isn't just any pilot flying any G.I. Joe Sky Striker. This is Ace.
Very good. And I think the timing of the production process probably lent itself towards having the artists being able to actually work on a cover that meets the theme of the issue, given that the lead in between you know, the idea of this issue and the eventual publication date meant that that's a lot of a longer lead than there would normally be, which somewhat necessitates a somewhat more abstract take on the cover cover B and the incentive covers. Cool.
Yeah. Wanted to mention real quick that actually Adam Gazowski was the one that colored my cover. It wasn't Jay. He did the interiors. Yep. Adam Gazowski, fellow Kubert School student with me, he also did the entire issue of 251. He did the cover. He colored my cover and the interiors as well. He is a great colorist. He was given the opportunity to recolor the entire Eastman and Laird Ninja Turtles run in a hardcover collection for IDW. So and he did great work on there. He did great work. Always does great work when he colors over me.
Thank you for the fact check.
And is this again where you're sort of seeking out and recommending a colorist that you know complements your style?
Yeah. When I had lost touch with Adam after school for a little while, and when I found out that he was doing color work for IDW at around the same time I was doing some projects for them, I said I want to work with him. And luckily enough, Tom was both our editors, so he made that happen. And anytime I get the opportunity to have Adam come on board on a project, permitting his schedule, because he's got his own things to do also, I always jump at it.
Cool. Let's go in for a plot breakdown and find out actually what happens in this story. Here we go. Cobra has launched an attack from its pterodromes in Frozenland onto the USS Flag, and we join the story as the Joes launch their planes from the damaged deck. Ace in the Sky Striker, Slipstream in the Conquest, and what's-his-name in the Phantom X-19 stealth fighter fly on a mission to neutralize the Cobra aircraft launch sites. The Cobras attempt to lure the Joes into a trap from their launch base protected by a cliff overhang, ready to launch Rattlers and Hurricanes from behind defensives of Sentry missile systems. The stealth fighter is able to take out those missile defenses, and Ace is able to blow up the base with his laser-guided bomb, but not before the Cobras launch their planes on a mission to attack the Flag. The Joes are able to shoot down the Cobras before they are able to reach the Flag, shake loose some jammed ordnance, and land back on the freshly repaired retrieval deck. Yo, Joe. Phew. Out of breath. It was a full-on issue. There was a lot of action. Tim, can I go over to you for your hot take?
Yeah, after issue 34 and Special Missions 5, I mean, I don't mean this storyline Special Missions 5, I mean 1987 Special Missions 5. You know, every couple of years, I really want an all-out aerial action, an AAAA issue of G.I. Joe, because I know that it's going to be great, and this is.
Oh, thanks, man.
Story and art. And it's also exciting to see Hama throw in so many characters. I appreciate that where Deep Six and Torpedo show up, right? They're not in costume, but they're doing something that a sort of non-named G.I. Joe team member would do to someone on the flight deck crew. But, you know, I don't need a lot of generic sort of non-player characters showing up in a G.I. Joe story. So it's like, oh, that's Deep Six, even though he's not wearing his costume. It's like, hey, neat. Whoever, you know, for whatever fan, Deep Six is their favorite. Deep Six is in this issue.
Yeah.
I think that once again, this is the second time in very recent memory that Hama has included a Techno Viper doing something very Techno Viper-y, which I appreciate because I really want to see the characters doing specifically what they do. You know, like I wouldn't mind seeing Ace and Slipstream in the jungle, whether or not they've just been shot down or they're just helping some Joes, but. There's a particular thrill in reading, you know, pilots doing cool pilot stuff, in seeing a Crimson Guardsman be a jerk to another Cobra because they kind of are superior. They're the fancier Cobra soldier, and the flight choreography. Haha. You know, I was thinking when I asked Alex that question, G.I. Joe is not an easy book to draw. This is not an easy issue to write. And it's not just that Hama is a veteran, it's that he does his research and he's thinking about this stuff. Mark, my top down is this is very exciting and satisfying. And you know, the hurricane, it's, you know, I don't know a lot of people who love the hurricane. I also haven't asked a lot of people.
Cobra base! Cobra Hurricane will stop you!
The vertical takeoff Hurricane has deadly missiles that really fire!
Fire!
But the G.I. Joe Avalanche has ice mines that really shoot!
Fire!
Missiles!
Fire!
And a detachable attack pod!
Now I've got you! Fire!
A real American hero! Get G.I. Joe
stop. Cobra Hurricane comes with pilot, G.I. Joe Avalanche with driver!
But, you know, I see the hurricane and I just think of that like very toyetic extra missile drone thing on the top and how goofy it looks in the Deke episodes with some really goofy sound effects. you know, like its colors are a little too bright for me. But I don't want just Rattlers and Night Ravens, you know. I want Real American Hero to embrace all the way to 94. So very exciting issue.
Yeah, I mean, I was left almost somewhat breathless at the pace of this issue. It felt like there was just so much being fit in to such a, you know, to into those 20 pages or so, and just action at such pace, you know, seeing all of those vehicles, the aerial combat, all of the different moving parts of the kind of the jigsaw that was being constructed in terms of the story, and trying to keep track of what was going on, who was where, what the different bits of peril were. It felt incredibly dense and you know, very carefully considered in terms of the way that the story is put together from the writing, but also the way that it was executed in the arts. And I sort of touch on some of the things that kind of stood out to me. We were dropped right in the middle of the action, and it's somewhat a counterpoint to actually the previous issue, the 278, where the story begins with Cobras at a pterodrome that's had an attack recently launched on it by the Joes, and the Cobras launching the counterattack. Here we've got the flag that has recently had the attack, and now the Joes launching their counterattack. It just feels very dense. We've got lots of technical jargon, lots of describing weaponry and keeping track of weaponry and what's happening with them. So very early on, we're introduced to this weapon rack glitch that is on the Sky Striker, which we return to by the end. We've got lots of time-bound peril. So the Joes have to get out there and attack the base before the Cobras are able to launch another attack. They've got to fix the landing strip on the flag so that the Joes can get back and land at the end of the mission. Otherwise, they'll have to ditch their planes in the drink. There's the Cobras, who are able to launch Rattlers every 2 minutes. There's this targeting system that's been taken offline, and the Techno Viper is rapidly trying to fix and bring it back online so that he can get those defenses back up and working. It's a whole lot going on in just a few pages. From the point of the script, and as you were drawing it, Alex, did it feel like that to you, that there was just this incredibly dense piece and trying to keep track of exactly what's happening and where did it feel like a bit of a jigsaw puzzle to unpick?
Yeah, especially towards the end, where you have the malfunction part of the story, kind of with the Sky Striker coming in, just the order in which some of the planes are trailing the others. But I mean, that's what your editor is there for, and that's what everybody else on the team is there for, to kind of keep you in check. You know, every time a page was turned in, a colored page even, our editor always asked, you know, hey guys, you guys see any inconsistencies, you know? And sometimes I don't think there were really any in this issue, but you know, that's what the team is there for, to help each other out. And I do remember at the time of working on this issue, just thinking, this reminds me, it's just like a good old fashioned air battle. You know, it's like just straight on. There's no sidetracking. There's no subplot that's going to spring off. You know, none of that. It's just straight on battle. And it reminded me kind of a little like the chase in Mad Max Fury Road, where it's just like one long chase scene. In some sense, it was kind of, it kind of harkens to that.
Yeah, and it's a point that I notice as well, is that in so much in a G.I. Joe comic, we often will see the focus on more of the characters, the characters involved and the the plot, and less so on the vehicles. And this is a very vehicle-centric issue, and specifically the plane-centric. Mm-hmm. And as Tim says, these are very few and in far between. There's issue 34. There's the issue, a couple of issues in special missions. So it's there was one with the Phantom a couple of years ago, as well. But yeah, they sort of come in a few in far between, and probably this feels, you know, a lot denser than those in terms of the number and the variety of mm-hmm. of planes in the air, and the sort of focus on those throughout the entirety of the issue. In fact, you know, we've been reading the Devil's Due issues, we've noticed before that some of those issues go by and you barely notice a vehicle in them at all. Whereas here it is, you know, it is their front and foremost in driving the story forward.
Yeah, I'm hoping that the reason, you know, they gave me a shot at this issue in particular is because they knew that I would be able to handle the amount of vehicles that was in the issue.
Also, in comparing this to earlier issues, right? Remember, everyone. Sorry, I mean, you guys all know this. Remember, listeners, the Marvel issues were 22 pages, and mm-hmm. the IDW issues are 20 pages. And I'm always, in a curious way, not in a critical way, as I read a modern story, wondering if I can see where the story may have breathed differently had this story been told 20 years ago. And initially I thought, I'm really enjoying this expositional dialogue on the first page that's catching me up. If this was two pages longer, would there have been more of the story unfolding at the very beginning? And I don't think so, because Hama has started in a lot of G.I. Joe stories, you know, just in the middle of, you know, like issue 97, you know, there's a couple Joes hiding behind cars and they're just getting shot up. And it's like, that's not like a B plot that was introduced earlier. It's like, no, these Joes are just Larry's just jumping into a new story. And then sometimes I wonder if at the end of an IDW issue, would this story have breathed a little differently with one or two more pages at the end? And I don't see it in this issue. I think this is a 20 page story that got told in 20 pages. The final panel, to me, echoes the finale of Special Missions, where the Joes land the Defiant on the flag, and then they all pose for the camera. And
I think I might have ended the issue 251 like that too, right? If you guys can remember,
yeah, put it in front of me, it's
I'm embarrassed to say I don't have it in front of me.
I
just had this bathtub full of 279. Can you hear it splashing? So the paper sliding. Is paper.
Just let me climb out of the vault and see, reach across to my other book. So 251 ends with Stalker sort of being given a pat on the back by his colleagues on the mission. And they say, are you kidding me? The Stalker man never drops the ball. Mission complete. Huh. So mission complete is the
for some
caption.
Reason I thought that they had all, you know, they were all pumping their fists in the air like they did in issue 279. But that was me. That wasn't in the script. It was just, you know, the G.I. Joes, I think if I remember, the G.I. Joes kind of gathered together and embrace each other somehow but there were two things in the last panel that I had to get in there. I had to get them in there pumping their fists, doing the traditional yo-jo call, and I had to get the Havoc in there because it's my favorite Joe vehicle.
This is the reason that the Havoc was there.
Yeah.
So as the kid in me loves this final panel, the critic in me, I want to say this gently because it's because the talented artist who drew it is listening. I think I'd rather you say to Tom, like, okay, you have to have me back in a year to draw an issue about the Havoc. I like seeing the Havoc. I want to see you draw the Havoc. Since the Havoc hasn't appeared in the issue thus far.
It's in the issue before, some of the pages, on top of on the flag. Oh, yep. Very small, but it's there.
Well, all right. fair enough.
Are you flicking back to see if she can spot it?
Also, to follow this thread, I don't begrudge anyone who's going to cram in their favorite stuff. And certainly if the final panel is open enough for you to interpret, you should interpret it. I think since the issue is all about the pilots, the Admiral, and Shipwreck, I think my preference would be in the final panel, that it's maybe like an hour later, all the planes have landed, and it's the guys that we just saw in the issue. Though I don't begrudge you for like fitting in.
Yeah,
fitting
I understand. Blowtorch. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, because I saw. I had a look on the message board to see what the discussion was about this issue, and one of the questions was, what was the Havoc doing on deck? If the elevator was down, was it the priority to get it down? And I come up with a mental no prize for that already, but it sounds like I don't actually need it. My no prize was they've just rushed to get the lift fixed, and they're lifting out the Havoc onto deck because they could use some of its defense capabilities. You know, it's got a big missile rack of missiles there, and it's got their cannons, and maybe they could use that as a defense as the rattlers are coming towards the ship.
It's really none of that. It's all for selfish reasons. You can blame me. I needed to put a Havoc somewhere. So yeah, you can blame me.
I was gonna say, Mark, the flying thing that comes out of the back of the Havoc. It's like, oh, Plan B is in case one of the pilots needs to eject, we need to fly out and pick them up or something.
Yeah. You know, this is why G.I. Joe fandom is so great, is because you guys are coming up with all these theories as why the Havoc there is there, and it's really just because I wanted to draw the Havoc.
I do like the fact that we've got the Joes there sort of pumping there and going, yo, Joe, but then we've also got Order down next to Law, and he's going, woof, woof.
Yeah. Those are... And throughout this entire issue, I wanted to get in as many of my favorite Joes in the as background characters as possible. So I don't know if we passed that point in the issue where Shipwreck and Keelhaul are on the deck, and in the background, and they're in the control room in the background, you can see the leads of both the animated movie and the Deke series. You got Lieutenant Falcon and Scoop talking to each other, looking at the damage of the flag outside.
Is this might be covered by a word balloon.
Is this
the tall panel where we see them in profile?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, out the window. There's a word balloon. Sorry. But thank you, because I like more, fewer green shirts and more specific Joes. That's my jam.
Had to get Scoop in there. I love the Deke series. I mean, they're not as good as your original, but they have a soft spot in my heart for sure.
Tim, you've also got somewhat, you much more of an expert on the Deke series than most, I think, as well.
I feel like that's its own not even podcast episode. I feel like there's a 10 episode podcast series where myself and some people talk about the Deke series, because there's a lot to talk about. There's a lot of good in amongst the not so good.
Yeah. Well, if that 10 part episode ever happens, please have me on when you guys talk about the theme song, because that theme song makes me want to run through a wall sometimes. It's so amazing.
Mark, what is next on our...
We've got talking points, and then we've got I Spy. I was just going to say, while we were talking about that last panel specifically, that one of the satisfying things for me is actually the colors in that panel. I do like the sort of setting sun at the end of the day. It's sort of the mission's drawing to a complete, mission's complete, and it's a satisfying sunset effect. I know that Tim's not always the greatest of fans of the coloring of the Joe book, but I think, it was a hell of a task on this one for the colorist. Jay Brown, and the differentiation of the sky and water that dominated a lot of the landscapes that were being dealt with here, you always got a sense of the kind of the geography and the positioning of the various things of where they are in the sky versus the sea, the land. I think it was generally pretty effective use of coloring, and even the more realistic photo elements that are kind of used in some of the sky and the sea. really worked for me. Was there much to-ing and fro-ing, Alex, with you and Jay as this was progressing? Was there questions coming about how to interpret specific things?
No, not really. I don't know if he's had prior experience working on like grayscale kind of artwork, but no, not really. I mean, the whenever I did like the sky and the background, that kind of stuff, I usually did it with like a mixed media, whether that be an airbrush or acrylic paints or whatever. So he had kind of like a template or direction. So I think we, in that sense, he knew how to treat my artwork.
I'm gonna raise the counter opinion.
Here come the nitpicker,
Timmy Finn.
Analytical prankster,
Timmy Finn.
Picking holes in your colouring,
Timmy Finn.
Still love G.I. Joe,
Timmy Finn.
No, no, he won't lie. Yes, he
testify.
Anyone can see there's some
criticism.
Anything that he don't know, ain't a thing that's worth to know. Pull him back and let him go. Criticism, here come the nitpicker,
Timmy Finn.
Analytical prankster,
Timmy Finn.
Picking holes in your colouring,
Timmy Finn.
Still a lot of your joke,
Timmy Finn.
Mark is correct. I am not always the biggest fan of the colouring in A Real American Hero. The photos for water and sky don't work for me. I find them distracting. And on the final page, the top left panel, where we're looking down at the flag, and the flag is sitting on a like 4-mile square printout of a photo of the ocean, right? Like, I don't.
I wish I had the issue in front of me.
I don't. Oh, then Mark, I'll address you. When I look at that panel, I don't see the flag sitting in and on actual water. I see something that was drawn sitting on a photograph as if it's like the flag toy on a table, and on the table is a photo. And every use of actual water photography and similarly does not work for me and takes me out of the story. I think that Alex draws very busy, exciting, detailed backgrounds, like all of these rocky cliff faces and some aggressive sort of dirt or ground where the Techno Viper is standing. And I think the colors need to do much less on these busy inked backgrounds because the inking is doing so much. And
that's a good point, Tim. That's actually whenever I, at the beginning of a project, when I get asked, you know, choose from these colors, basically, I basically tell my editor, you choose, just find a colorist that is the opposite of the way I draw, which is I'm very detailed, busy. I need someone that just basically puts on flat colors because the work is already there. You only have to put the color on top of it, you know, basically. So, I don't know. I wish I had the issue in front of me so I can kind of see what you're talking about. But I know that I was, in general, I'm happy with the way the issue came out.
I'll quickly point out two more examples of where I don't think Brown's color agrees with this book. One is on page 6. There's a top panel. First time we see the Techno Viper, and he's at a control panel for a missile launcher. And the light source for the missiles, which is just behind him, is from above. And the light source for the control panel is in front of them. So I see this in many issues of G.I. Joe, where everything is rendered, everything has a highlight. There's a lot of K, there's a lot of black mixed into colors. I find it muddy. My final example is on page 8. There's this, what looks like a dust cloud of glowing green emerald crystals, but it's actually a forest. It's actually a bunch of trees. And Brown, when he colors the desert around the pit, to me, it doesn't look like sand. It looks like orange lava. When he colors trees, whether it's at night or at day, there are all these tiny, glinty, soft, round highlights. I think this book needs, this book and particularly this issue needs less rendering.
Mm-hmm. Are we able to get, should we move on to I Spy, where we just have a look at little details that we've noticed?
Yeah.
I spy with my little eye.
Okay.
Okay.
I spy no females in a lead role in this issue.
Yeah.
Which is only, I guess, worth noting just purely because of if you've been reading the recent issues of G.I. Joe, it has been very much front and center that the female characters are you know, playing such a huge part of the book. You know, Dawn, Granny Demon, Felix, Bomb Strike, Laura, the Crimson Guard. I could go on and on and on. Curious to just to note and observe that for this one, we've, I think, only got Lady J on that last panel.
And she was thrown in there because I wanted to draw Lady J, so she wasn't even in the script that I can remember.
I was gonna joke, I spy Falcon and Scoop hiding behind a word balloon on page 2. I shouldn't say this definitively because every time I do, I'm wrong. But is this the first appearance of Vapor, the Hurricane pilot?
I believe it's the first appearance of both Vapor and the Hurricane.
That's so I spy that.
I spy the Sentry missile system. So I understand that this was released as a Sears exclusive in 1985, originally released as a red Hiss tank with a red painted missile rack on tow.
I spy when Ghost Rider, the pilot of the stealth, does show up. I feel like there's always a very specific... I guess it does happen. I guess he says it this time. He's like, you still don't remember my name. But I feel like whenever he shows up, it's someone else who refers to the fact that they can't remember his name. So I guess this isn't even worth calling out because the joke is maintained.
We've got, I thought this was a really cool little touch. We've got the Crimson Guard as kind of the lead Cobra in this issue, which is, again, an echo of what we had in last issue, where we had a snow serpent as the as kind of the lead Cobra. And there's a particularly nice touch that when he's sort of in the Hurricane or the other vehicles, he's sort of plugged in with this breathing apparatus tube that feeds into the bottom of his mask. I thought that was just a really cool little touch.
I think that was my idea too, because how are they going to breathe when they're at high altitudes?
Yeah, it's perfect. I didn't even, it sort of felt so natural. I didn't even pick up on it on the first read, but yeah, it's sort of just this, you know, nice little touch. You sort of sitting, getting into the Hurricane. There's this little hole in the bottom of his mask and you sort of just this hint of this tube. And the next time you see it, it's all plugged in. Yeah. Just one of those things that just makes sense and works. Okay, my last I spy was that on board an AV aircraft carrier flight deck, the crew has different color uniforms, which distinguish the sort of the role that they play. And we've seen this before, that in Silent Option, there was a reference to blue shirts on deck, which was they handle logistics. And this time around, we had Deep Six in a red shirt, which denotes that he's an ordnance handler, and Torpedo in a green shirt, which denotes that he's looking after the catapult and arresting gear crew. So nice little touch, sort of educating us on real world aircraft carrier roles. Green shirt as opposed to the Devil's Due green shirt, which denotes that they're infantry.
Yeah.
Cool. Let's move on to Alex, was there any little sort of mini Easter eggs and things that that you wanted to point out that maybe we've not spotted?
I think I've, you know, between all three of us, we've pointed them all out. Yeah.
You know, actually on the final page, Scoop and Falcon are in the Havoc. You just can't see them because of the reflection on the cockpit.
Are they?
No, sorry, I'm doing a bit.
Oh, okay. I was like, I don't remember drawing that.
Very good. Was there an element that was particularly satisfying to draw that you were most proud of, and was there an element that you found trickiest?
The pages I'm most proud of are probably the pages that have the heaviest mixed media work on them. Mm-hmm. You know, the heaviest paintwork, the heaviest colored pencils and all that stuff. And then I would say the most difficult page is, I'm looking at the original pages here. Page 6. Because working out the positioning of the character in the foreground amongst all this cavernous background took me a little while. It took me longer than I expected.
I'm guessing that embedded in that statement is that in the plot you got from Hama, it says something like, down in the valley with mountains behind it, a techno viper stands in front of the missile control panel. It's like this missile thing and four hiss tanks, and there's like, what's the netting called that hides?
There's a technical term which he wrote in the script that I just can't recall, but yes.
And there's also a little bit of water.
He did describe the net. Yep. He did describe.
There's a pond or a stream behind him. And so, one guy, four vehicles, an accessory, another accessory, the geography, all in one panel, and then also, you know, leave room for word balloons to not cover up important stuff.
Yeah. Okay, I take it back, Tim and Mark. The most difficult page was actually page 5, because it had the interior of the pterodrome landing platform, and the last panel, you see all the ceiling of the structure. Mm. I remember that drawing all that stuff in perspective took me a little while. So between those two, between pages 5 and 6, those were the ones that I spent the sleepless nights on.
I think because I like techno vipers so much, I think my favorite page is 6.
Oh yeah.
But you know, that's the page with no aerial action, at least outside of a cockpit. So.
Yeah, that's my friend is a huge G.I. Joe fan, my best friend, and he's been trying ever since I finished it for me to give him that page or sell it to him or whatever.
You should definitely sell it to him for at least $400.
I don't know. I can't feel like I'm taking advantage of him since he's my best friend. I'll trade it to him for like a toy or something.
Any less and maybe he's taking advantage of you.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, sure. Let's move on to error detected.
Error detected. Error detected. No prize incoming.
All right, I'll start on page 19. This is the second to last page. The final panel, we're looking down at the Sky Striker as it's flying angled toward us. And then below it is the flag, because I see part of a 9 for 99. And the entire ocean that we're looking at, that the flag, because we're looking down past a plane at an aircraft carrier, the entire ocean is in fact a photograph of the sky. And I guess my no prize is that the ocean reflects the sky. But
nice.
And then... on page 17, in the second to last panel, right, the hurricane's coming toward us, and there's a jet behind it which has just fired two missiles. And the vapor is saying, where did that stealth come from? But the jet behind it is the conquest. And when I read this, I wasn't sure if that should be the stealth, or if the stealth is like off panel. And that's sort of the surprise of the vapor, is that sort of he can't see it either. And I'm sorry to say I don't have a no prize for this. I wondered if I'm reading this wrong, or if something in the art or the dialogue here is glitchy.
I am just as confused as you are. I have no idea, and I can't recall.
In the dialogue, on the next page as well, it says, "Thanks for saving my bacon, buddy." You know, because he can't remember Ghost Rider's name, and he replies, "No problem, Slipstream." So it does imply that from the dialogue that it is the stealth that has saved the conquest.
I've got one more, which is page 1415. The final panel of page 14, wordless, no dialogue, no sound effects. Conquest is launching a missile, which is very big in the panel, close to us. Mm-hmm. And I don't have my Conquest in front of me, but I recall each wing gets two yellow missiles and a gray bomb or external fuel tank, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. So it's just launched one of its yellow missiles. And then on the next panel, on the next page, first panel, the next page, it appears to have a full complement of its missiles.
Ah, that I raise my hand. That must be my fault.
So my no prize is that in the game that I'm, where the story is just a game that I'm imagining as I'm holding my toys, right? It's like these vehicles have, you know, it's like Metalhead firing missiles in the Deke episodes. He fires his missiles and then he has more missiles, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, the Conquest fires a missile and then I just grab a piece of plastic and I stick it back on and then I fire another missile.
Okay. The one that I spotted was just a speech balloon, which is pointing at the wrong place. So it is on, I'll have to figure it out. So I think it's 16. The bottom panel has got two Rattlers with the Conquest behind them. And there's a speech bubble pointing at the Hurricane. And the speech bubble says, "Lost lock on one of them, and now I have a Hurricane on my six," which I think should be pointing towards the Conquest, but these things.
I've got half of an error detected on... doing this sort of scratches my nerd itch, but it also makes me sad. Because, you know, I want to be positive. Anyway, on page six, the aforementioned and mentioned page six, which introduces the Techno Viper. In the first panel, I think the Techno Viper is talking. I think he's saying, "I've got a glitch in my targeting system."
Mm-hmm.
And the outline of the word balloon is one of those, like, it's coming from a radio word balloons. Mm. So there are wiggly lines to show that it's like,
yeah.
coming from a speaker.
Right.
So I usually that means that we're hearing, it's like that points to sort of the earpiece of this, I guess, Techno Viper. Mm-hmm. But I think he's saying it. So I guess he's saying it and I don't know, he's radioing it to them. And then similarly in the next panel, I think he's continuing to observe while I'm offline, while my missiles are offline, someone else is going to have to do the missiles. Do you acknowledge someone else? And then in the next panel, he says, "I've got you covered, number two." And then a couple pages late, one, two, three pages later, the Techno Viper is fixing his missile control panel. And his word balloons are normal. They're not the sort of electric talking through a radio.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is a lettering issue. I lost the thread here of sort of who the Techno Viper was talking to and which person doesn't have missile capability.
I believe he's talking to the I could be completely wrong, but I think he's talking to the Cobra Viper. Or the, not the Viper, the Crimson Guard.
Who's up in the plane?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. I, you know, now and then, I mean, not just in G.I. Joe, but now and then in comics, I'll see, you know, a word balloon that's aiming in the wrong direction or someone who's the wrong color. And I always cross my fingers and hope that when this story gets collected in a,
they fix
paperback, they fix it. And more immediately, since that paperback may be a couple months away, you know, the digital files for people reading online, I think that's a little easier to fix. So my fingers are crossed that these word balloons.
Yeah, I mean, it just all depends on how much time and how much of the team they can devote to that stuff, you know. But they should.
Yeah,
I'm not
going to
make excuses for them.
They have before tried to fix stuff in between the individual issues coming out and the trade.
That's good. I don't have the trades because I have the issues. So I should also add, if they have fixed mistakes, thank you. I didn't notice, but thank you. Thank you, team.
yeah, I think there was a Rob Atkins was talking about the time we're in the Snake Hunt when there were some G.I. Joes colored to look like Cobra troopers that are clambering on top of a vehicle, and that they didn't catch that in time for print, but we're going to try and fix it for the trade. And I imagine that the trade is probably still a little ways off, because I don't think we've even had the Snake Hunt trade come out yet. So so I think there's time to do it.
Yeah.
Cool.
Going back to a top line reaction, I know I've said this before. I love Hama's ongoing story, right? The soap opera, the world building, the, you know, B plot and C plot that then becomes the A plot a couple months later. I love the cliffhangers. Hama is particularly strong with single issue stories, and I always find those satisfying. The original special missions, the more recent special missions, Untold Tales, the very occasionally issue just inside the IDW run, which ends up being self-contained. And you know, I don't give these to people to read because I don't know random family members and strangers who want to read a G.I. Joe comic in 2021, but we do sell it at my store. But it's these self-contained issues that I would enjoy giving to people to read.
Okay, let's move on to Hama Time.
Time to beat the soles of your boots with my face. Sucking chest wounds, red ninjas, brain scanners, rubber hoses, blue ninjas. And then some more sucking chest wounds. Hama Time.
So this is a segment where we look at any sort of recurring motifs that that Larry likes to employ in his stories and turns of phrase and so on. I think across this issue, there's just there's a number of things around sort of the specificity of all of the ordnance that is being used and the colloquialisms and the jargons that are being employed. There's a lot of there's even a lot of editor call-outs in this issue, sort of to try and explain some of them. The one that I'll hone in on is the specific turn of phrase of Winchester, which has fast become one of his favorites to denote that someone is running dry on their armaments. And I think it might even occur three times in this issue, or at least twice. But one of his new favorite terms of phrase that we've seen over the last few issues. Was there anything from you, Tim?
Yeah. Deep Six saying, but be warned, one of the triple ejector racks for the MK-82s caught flak damage, and there's no time to swap it out. You're carrying three bombs that might not pickle. Copy. This is more a plot point than it is a little turn of phrase. Hama creating a small problem or deficiency, which a character specific to, like, weapons or gear, right? Like, the radio's broken, but not even that general, right? It's like the antenna got snapped, something like that. And then later on, you know, Ace may or may not be able to drop this ordinance. And then again, generally in the story, sort of the choreography of which plane is where who has to cover who and who's out of ammo.
And then on to colloquialisms.
There used to be a pudding that was over-egged. You know the pudding. You know the pudding. At first it was British, but then it was Commonwealth. You know the pudding. You know the pudding. But now there's a new player in town. A comic book writer of some renown. He's using real world examples and peppering the issues with lots of samples. It's a Larry Hama colloquialism. He's talking G.I. Joe and all its heroism. Can you guess what it is? Is it something new? Now listen as Larry drops a slice of real life on you.
Slipstream mentions Yo Joe Cola on the second to last page. Is that a Hamaism or is that a is that colloquialism?
That's a drink.
I don't think we've seen it referred to in a bit.
Yeah, there was certainly lots of jargon and sort of turns of phrases. I noticed references to pulse Dopplers, EMRs, GBU runs, and all aspect sparrows. There was a turn of phrase which was money run when I think it might have been Ace was talking about making a money run. And I looked this up, and I don't know if this is what it was in reference to, but there was a book and an adaptation that referred to this, that in 1971, the US military delivered their payroll in Okinawa in unmarked bills on a single helicopter, and that payroll flight was called the Money Run. So I don't know if that's linked, but it's certainly an interesting interesting reference.
I when I read the script, I always took it as just, all right, this is our one shot, our last shot to handle business, you know, against Cobra.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, it definitely reads as something along those lines. It was just interesting turn of phrase that I can't remember hearing before.
And he had a lot of those, like you had mentioned before in this issue. This one of the harkens back to what we talked about earlier about like the difference between the way Larry writes and maybe another writer who was handling a military themed series.
Yeah. It's definitely those lines and those turns of phrases that, and specificity around the the weaponry and some of those military jargon that you just wouldn't get from another writer. And I guess you don't necessarily even see those until you see the finished page, because they're not necessarily going to be defined in the Larry's Marvel style script.
Alex, you're drawing from the plot, and then you saw colored pages later, and you did not see lettered pages?
The PDF, did it have, sometimes it does have the letter. Yeah, I did see the finished with the lettering. I did. Yeah.
Righto. Okay.
Another one I picked up was when they said, in the dialogue, settle that conquest hash. Settling a hash is another interesting phrase that I wouldn't use in everyday language. So I looked this up, might expect, it means to kind of subdue or to get rid of something or someone. So he's talking about settling that conquest hash, as in sort of dealing with it and blowing it out the sky. The hash in question is a mess that's been made out of things, and apparently it's been around since around 1800. A long-standing turn of phrase, but getting another airing here. Did you have a favorite line of dialogue?
Quote of the week, quote of the week. Quote of the week, quote of the week.
Quote of the week, quote of the week.
Quote of the week.
I did. On page 1, 2, 3, 4, the Crimson Guard has gotten into the hurricane and is saying to the pilot, the Vapor, he's putting him in his place, and he's saying, The pawns are sacrificed to lure the powerful pieces away from the king, leaving the king exposed and at the mercy of rooks and knights. Over these three panels, these two have this conversation explaining the idea behind which jets are needed to, you know, go attack the flag, and that the flag is vulnerable because only three jets got off the flag. So here's a metaphor which explains in one sentence the entire issue, which has already, I mean, the issue has already been explained to you, and now you get to see it all play out. It's just a nice turn of phrase, a nice metaphor. Yeah.
And also prefaced by the Crimson Guard saying to him, you're just a vapor. You aren't seeing the big picture.
Yes, yes. So I guess my favorite line is two word balloons spoken by one person continuously.
Yeah. The one I had a hard time figuring out which one to go for, but I thought it was a panel that you referred to earlier where they're on deck and the person in the red shirt, which is Deep Six, was just giving a whole bunch of ordnance extrapolation of what's going on. So he goes, okay, Ace, you're loaded for bear with six MK-82 500 pounders, two MK-84 paveways, and two AIM-7 AA missiles. Yeah, which kind of puts me in mind of Harrison Ford saying to George Lucas, you know, you can write this stuff, but you can't, say it. You can write this stuff. But also that specificity of Hammer of, you know, really outlining, you know, the detail of the ordnance, you know, being employed, which, you know, does play into a plot point as the story progresses, both in terms of, you know, what the various aircraft have got to work with in the air before they're fully, you know, expended and running Winchester. And then, you know, he follows on to talk about this ejector rack that's caught flak damage, which again is a point of peril that needs to be resolved by the by the end of the issue.
Mm-hmm. Who is the MVP? Most valuable person in these issues. Who is the MVP? Is it a Cobra Joe or the enemy?
So, MVP, who was our favourite character in this particular issue? Alex, let's start with you.
It's gotta be Ace.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Or the Havoc. Yeah, just Ace because I believe he's the one that sprinkled throughout most of the issue. Mm-hmm. He's the avatar of the reader, I guess.
Yeah, for me, maybe it's probably a toss up between the Vapor, just in terms of just the novelty of seeing the character appear for the first time. It's, you know, always cool to see these characters that have been in existence for a very long time. Because yeah, the figure was introduced in 1990, so after all, it has been in existence for, I guess, over 30 years at this point.
Yeah.
But never being seen in an ARAH story, or maybe
that's odd. I mean, I would have figured that by now he would have been in at least an issue or two.
Yeah, I mean, these things happen. I had thought that the Snow Serpent hadn't appeared until the last issue, but I realized that there's been at least one issue that they had appeared before issue 278. So that's a fact correction for the last episode. There was an issue that SL Gallant did the cover for where Blizzard is sort of sneaking up on a Snow Serpent about to whack him with the butt of his rifle, which I shamefully actually own the cover to that.
Wow. Oh yeah.
And so I actually have that piece of art, but I still forgot that Snow Serpent has previously appeared.
You're talking about a first appearance of Snow Serpent version 1 or 2?
1.
Okay.
Yeah. I think that may have still been the first appearance of Snow Serpent version 2. And my other MVP sort of was the toss up between the Vapor, just for it being novelty, and the Crimson Guard, because, you know, whenever you've got a sort of a a sort of more infantry character, you know, where they're the Cobra Legions, but they're sort of you know, stepping up into a kind of a lead role. It's I always find that quite quite satisfying, particularly if they act like a total a-hole like this guy is.
Yeah. It's an interesting choice, which, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, that's kind of something, I think you might have even mentioned it earlier, it's kind of something that Larry likes to do, is pick, you know, those regular characters and put them up on a pedestal for the issue or for the story or whatever reason.
Yeah, and I think it works.
My my MVPs are Falcon and Scoop, because for them to get from the deck of the flag behind keelhaul and shipwreck, right, when the whole thing's on fire, to the cockpit of the Havoc, right, the story. My actual MVP is the Techno Viper, because I love purple. And I desperately always want to see all these various Vipers doing very specifically what the toy sort of has them doing. So I want to see Techno Vipers fixing things. I don't mean like computer fixing things, you know, they come with a giant wrench, like fixing a tank. And to have this Techno Viper fixing the missile launcher, but also operating the missile launcher, and then that he's checking in with someone else. It's like, well, my missiles aren't working, what about you? And then later on, a non-detective stealth fighter, right? Like, oh, there must be three jets up there, right? So he's reading the tea leaves, or I guess he's actually figuring out the evidence. But then he gets this dramatic line of dialogue. He's on his knees, which has body language I really like, how he's down to fix the control panel. But I have to get it up and running or our launch base is doomed. I love seeing the Techno Viper. I love that he gets to do several things, and he's a bad guy, and he doesn't make it out of the story. So the arc is complete.
Yeah. Very good. Okay, and then Yo Joeage. So this is where we give the rating out of 10, and we're under slightly more pressure than we would normally be because we've got the artist of the issue with us. So I'll go first. So I thought it was enormously satisfying issue. It was very much its own thing as well. So sometimes it feels like maybe the issues are kind of coasting along, or it's an issue that's part of an overall plot. But this is very much, you know, it says it's an untold tale, it's one and done. But more beyond that, it's, I think, an issue that is very much its own thing and stands out outside of the pack of the others in terms of, you know, the way that there's this focus on this you know, really very focused mission with all of the planes and this you know, bombastic aerial combat that we see that was so satisfying. So yeah, definitely I think it's an issue that stands head and shoulders above the average that we would see for the IDW run. I enjoyed it a lot, and I would rank it quite highly as such. So sort of I'd put it up there. I think last time I gave an 8, so I think to be fair I would probably rank it alongside that and go with another 8.
Ooh, that's nice, thanks.
I'm going to give this an 8. This is a great story with great art and great storytelling. As we've said, because it's self-contained, it works on additional levels. And as a store owner and also as someone who likes to give away comics on Halloween, and I fantasize about just giving a lot of G.I. Joe comics away to lots of people, whether I know them or not, I can do this with this issue. I've been thinking about what would get to a 9 or a 10, because I haven't gone higher than an 8. This isn't fair, but you know, reading a comic is so much of the object for me, right? It's the actual object that I'm holding. You know, I don't love the color on this series, and there are a couple errors in this issue, which confused me. But With my magic wand, IDW would print on flat paper. As both a reader, right? I sit under a lamp, and when I read comics, if there's a glare on my page, this isn't IDW, this is everyone, right?
Yeah.
I should say most of the publishers. I really like flat paper.
You mean like matte paper?
Yeah.
Tim?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, geez, I wish it would go back to newsprint paper, actually, to be honest with you.
And newsprint is more expensive. Sort of strangely, it's more expensive than a coated stock. But DC will trot it out. They've got this. They've done some of their Jack Kirby reprints in the last few years on it. Mm-hmm. On this, I don't know if it's technically a newsprint, but it looks and feels like a newsprint.
Yeah. I think the actual newsprint is it just deteriorates too quickly. But whatever, something like a newsprint, you know, like I think this stock paper that they're using, it's too slick, it's too glossy,
it's also too,
and it doesn't smell like newsprint like the old newsprint stuff does.
It's also too heavy. When I pick up a short box or a long box of modern comics versus a long box or short box of older comics, when I pick up a diamond, you know, our distributor, like a diamond box filled with modern like Marvel paperbacks, it's like we get these double diamond boxes and they have a sticker on them that says team lift, right? Like two people should lift
this. Yeah, you need more than one. Yeah.
45-pound box.
Wow.
And, you know, and I'm sure like, you know, a business person or a VP at IDW would say like, that doesn't matter. You know, it's the issue. And also the entire infrastructure of colorists and pre-production is about, it's like the levels and saturation that we print on this paper, which can absorb this much ink, as opposed to you'd color it differently if you knew you were getting a different paper. DC, I don't know what it's called, DC Comics publishes some of their books on a very thin, flat stock. And this isn't a helpful example, but I know that the like the Andy Kubert Damien miniseries from like 4 years ago, it was four issues. Other things have been published on this, but that was published on that stock. It absorbs all of this modern, exciting computer color, and the blacks are not as rich as on a coated stock, but they look great, and it's not heavy, and it doesn't reflect the light bulb behind me.
No.
So, sorry, I'm going off on a tangent.
No, it's interesting. Actually, I'll probably email Andy about it. Andy was my mentor in the second year of the Kubert School. So it's an interesting question to bring up to him.
Aha. Well, my manager and I at my shop, we talk a lot about, you know, comics as objects and paper stock and French flaps and logo design. Every so often we pick up a new DC book and we point to it and we say, oh, it's that paper. You know, Marvel doesn't use it. This is a solid eight. This is a high eight. And I don't know that how likely it is, but for IDW issue for me to get to a 9 or a 10, I think I'd need different paper and different color.
Okay, that's unreasonable, Tim. And Alex, you're welcome to give yourself a score, or we can just take it as read that it's a 10.
Well, I probably can't give you a score, but what I will say, I will compare it to issue 251. And I will say that 279 is not only my favorite Joe project that I've worked on, but one of my most famous favorite projects that I've ever worked on, just because I'm drawing G.I. Joe. I'm completing the bucket list with the mixed medium. And the experience of always working with Tom and Larry has been great. So this is up there for me. I'm not going to give it a rating because I can't really... You know, if I'm going to rate my own artwork or anything that I've worked on, I'm probably going to give it a low rating, because every time I'm done with anything I've done, I always can pick out, you know, the errors.
Yeah, you can only see
Right. I mean, I don't have any of my artwork hung up or anything like that. I don't like looking at my own artwork. But I will definitely say that this was such an enjoyable project and I had a great time and yeah.
Okay, cool. So I think that's all us all wrapped up on our talk of 279.
Mark talks about toys, ho ho.
He talks about G.I. Joe. He talks about all the toys from the comic book and the animated show. Mark talks about toys. Mark talks about toys.
Yeah, I want to hear Alex talk about a G.I. Yeah. Joe toy.
So Alex, over to you. What G.I. Joe toys do you want to talk about?
25th anniversary, but I actually have a cool little story about how I came to own a USS flag. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted one ever since I was a kid. I remember asking my mom at a Woolworths whether she can buy the USS flag for me, and she said no, it costs too much money. So my friend Bobby, who I believe owns one of the, he's in the definitely in the top 10 as far as largest G.I. Joe action figure, Real American Hero collections. And this guy has three USS flags. He worked at Hasbro, so I'm sure he had connections or something. And the guy had three USS flags. I said to him, stop being greedy. How can I get one of your USS flags? He said, I don't know. You think of something. So what I did was I create custom figures. I created a 12-inch custom Steel Brigade figure with his head sculpt underneath the helmet. And I decked it out. I decked it out with all kinds of ammo and guns, submachine guns, hand weapons, knives. I even put in a backpack, completely decked it out, put everything inside a military hard case, an actual wartime used military hard case that I found online. And we traded that for the USS flag. And I have the USS flag now. I still haven't put it together because I have to go through it and see what pieces are missing, buy them, and then I want to do a whole kind of restoration upgrade thing on it where I'll make it look weathered. I'll give it actual LED working lights and monitors. And when I'm done with it, I'm going to film the process for my YouTube channel when I eventually launch it in the next month or so. But it's going to be like basically the build a USS flag project, which I will document and show to everyone that's listening.
That and this is Bobby Valla that you did this.
Bobby Valla, yeah. He the Action Force, owner of Action Force. I also did an issue. He's actually self-publishing Action Force comics. You can buy them on the Vallaverse website, and he's up to issue 3 or 4 now. And I did the Steel Brigade story in the 3rd issue, which came out a few weeks ago.
Yeah, and he's known in the community as the Steel Brigade.
He is the, I mean, he owns the largest collection of Steel Brigade vintage figures, and he also has the caps and the patches and the certificates that each, I mean, he's a completist, so he has it all. So, of course, I had to do a custom Steel Brigade figure for him.
Alex, where will in your home, how will you display this super flag?
Well, I am fortunate enough to have a large art studio where I have my toys and collectibles. I have my art equipment. I have my printing equipment. I have all my business equipment here, so I have the space. It's already set up. It just needs to be put together, thankfully. Otherwise, it'd be like our dinner table or something upstairs in my house.
And make sure as well that you check out on YouTube our good friends over at G.I. Joburg, who did a big flag project, and they actually attached floats and so on to the bottom.
Yep, I saw that.
Launched it out onto sea. Fantastic.
Oh, really? That's great. That's great. I tried to get my hovercraft to float when I was a little kid, but it didn't work out.
Oh, crumbs. Okay. What else do you want to talk about toys? So you've got your 25th anniversary. Have you still got any sort of the vintage line as well from your childhood?
No. I unfortunately, I told you about my mom throwing out my comics. Mm-hmm. I used to keep all my action figures, my toys, in my mom's office in her business when she had a business, because after school I would go there and hang out. You know, we didn't have a babysitter, so I kept all my Joes and my vintage Star Wars figures all in her office. And then one day She got her office was broken into. Everything was taken. I lost all my toys, and I had to start over from scratch. But I never did start collecting the vintage Joes again because I don't know. I mean, I had so many. I had even more than my Star Wars figures. I just didn't. I couldn't commit. I was probably collecting other things at that time. So it wasn't until 25th anniversary came around where I was like, all right, time to get back into G.I. Joe.
And you immersed yourself in the 25th anniversary collection. What's your favorite figure or couple of figures from that particular?
I'm actually holding my two favorite figures right now. One of them is the Sergeant Slaughter San Diego Comic-Con exclusive, not the the USA the one that has the USA on his outfit, but the one that you could see in the cartoons, the regular blank top, the top, and this figure, all I can say is that this is the figure that completed my 25th anniversary line, because I already have all the other figures that are cartoon accurate. I don't have every figure in the line, but I have the ones that best represent the cartoons. So this figure was the last one I needed, and maybe about 5 years ago, he was going for about $120, something like that. And last year, I was snooping around, you know, the internet to see if I can buy one, and they were going for like $250, something like that. They had basically doubled in value in the last 5 years. And I was like, no, I can't do that right now. I can't spend $250. I had a fan of my comic book work reach out to me who also happens to be a toy grader. So he's a huge Star Wars fan and is a huge fan of the work I did for Star Wars The Old Republic back in when Dark Horse had the license. And he's like, do you have this mini comic of Star Wars The Old Republic? And this mini comic was only available at San Diego Comic-Con in 2008, I believe. They flew the creative team out. They flew me in and the rest of the writer out there to do a signing at San Diego Comic-Con. And they printed up these mini, like, hollow foil wraparound Star Wars comics. They made, like, 500 of them, I think, or something like that. I did the cover for it also, wraparound. You can see I love wraparound covers for some reason. So he was like, do you have that? I'm like, I think I might have a stack of them. Let me go check. So I checked. I had a nice little handful of them. He's like, if you give me two, sign them both, I'll get them graded, and they'll stay in my collection forever. I was like, sure. Can you buy me the Sergeant Slaughter figure? And he said, absolutely. So he bought me the Sergeant Slaughter figure, and he also got me an alien figure by NECA. So that was the bookend for my 25th anniversary collection and a cool little story that attached to it.
Excellent. And yeah, if it's a swap, then it's free.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Alex, I asked you about where you got your comics as a kid. Was there was there a toy store nearby?
Well, there was. It was a small, I don't know how big or small they were, but it was a chain toy store called Kitty City. I don't know if you guys are familiar, or if you're familiar with it, Tim, being here on the East Coast, I believe.
Yeah, Lionel Kitty City.
Yeah. They were more prevalent here in the city during the 80s than Toys R Us was. We didn't get a Toys R Us until the mid 90s. And then that was like a small little, you know, small little crappy Toys R Us until the big Times Square one came around. But yeah, Kitty City. Comic book stores, like I mentioned, Big Apple Comics, West Side Comics, and Funny Business Comics were my go-to.
Were you getting toys at drugstores or?
Yeah, pharmacies, stationery stores. I mean, even this past, you know, a few days ago, I went to the stationery toy store by my mom's. I was visiting her, and I found a seven-year-old mint-packaged Ninja Turtles figure from the Nickelodeon series from 2012. And the guy's like, I think we might have more of these. I'm like, do you realize that this figure is about 7-8 years old already? He's like, oh, no, I didn't realize that. So it's like, what a, you know, a gem you could find, like someplace that I never thought they would have, like a toy this. I mean, it's not that old, but I was definitely the local toy store guy growing up. you know, we didn't really have big chain stores, like I mentioned, like a Toys R Us. Kitty City was here for, you know, 3, 4, 5 years, and then it was gone. Then after that, and even before that, it was buying these kinds of toys at the local toy shops, pharmacies, and stationaries.
And this is New York City, just to clarify.
Yep. Yeah, you, which is strange.
Were you were you allowed to go on the subway or the bus by yourself at an early age?
Not until I was, I think, like 13.
Okay.
My mom did not even allow us to go to Central Park with unattended.
Okay. Because, you know, for kids in the suburbs, the only way to get to the comic or bookstore is if, you know, your parent drives you.
Yeah. No, I've been collecting toys ever since I was a kid. I never really stopped. I took a little break in the early 2000s because I became so frustrated with transforming the Masterpiece Transformers that I was like, I don't want to deal with toys anymore. And I sold everything. But I've always collected toys. And from the time that my mom would allow me to venture off on my own, I always grabbed a bicycle or a skateboard or rollerblades and made those toy treks and, you know, went toy hunting. To this day, I still do it.
Cool. And you said you had a second figure.
Actually a custom figure. And I loosely say custom because it's the comic book 2-pack Snake Eyes. He came with a Storm Shadow or maybe like a ninja figure, but it's a 2-pack, you know, 25th anniversary released comic 2-packs where it included an original raw comic reprint.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And is this the Battle Damage Snake Eyes?
No, it's the other one, where he's basically all blue.
Uh-huh.
But I love, my favorite Snake Eyes is the very first cartoon Snake Eyes, which has, like, you could see his hands, and he's got purple in the visor, and he's got purple in his little pouches. So I took that blue Snake Eyes, swapped out the blue gloved hands for some skin-colored hands, and I painted him with little highlights of purple where they were in the cartoon. And this is like one of my favorite figures because I just love that Snake Eyes. And I love the one that the radiation Snake Eyes too that they made.
That's like so niche.
I know. But I mean that series is what made me fall in love with G.I. Joe. Like I said before, the comics. I know the comics came out a little bit before them, but I wasn't that hip to reading comics just yet. Mm-hmm. So the cartoons were, and that first series, to this day, I think is the best thing that G.I. Joe cartoons has ever done. Maybe aside from Resolution, uh-huh. the one-hour special animation thing that they did. That's fantastic too.
Very good. You'll have to shoot me a photo of your custom.
Yeah,
I'll
definitely.
I'll drop it in on the social media and the YouTube when we put that together.
Sure.
Cool. Yeah, I think, we've been talking a long time, but it's as always, it has flown by. So we'll probably have to wrap up as much as I'd think. Love to keep on talking. We've taken up enough of your day.
No. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you guys for inviting me. And hopefully if I work on another G.I. Joe project relatively soon, you guys will have me back.
Yeah, it would be an absolute privilege to have you back as it has been to have you on the show today. And it's been great talking to you, seeing behind the scenes on your art processes as well. That's been very interesting to hear and just get sort of some of the stories from your side as we both love hearing about the process of how these things come together, because comics are complicated and they're hard work, and sometimes you just breeze through a comic and you forget about all of the effort and work that's gone into making the thing.
Yeah, it is a tough industry to get into. Mm-hmm. But to maintain, there's a lot of networking that you have to do, a lot of not politicking, but you know, you have to pick and choose your spots. Mm-hmm. You have to become familiar with people's personalities, editors' personalities, and like I mentioned before, first year of the Kubert School, we had a student body of 200, and by the third year, I think we were down to like 30. So, you know, the tough stick around. Yeah. The, you know.
Wow. So where can if people want to find out more about you and your work, where can people best find you?
You can find me on Facebook, Alex Sanchez art page. I have an art page there. You can find me on Instagram at Ironhed77. I'm pretty active on both. And then I also have a Friday toy review show with a couple of other buds called the Infinity Equation Podcast. It's on Fridays here in the States at 8 p.m. Eastern. And we talk about toys, toy news of the week, and we talk about our toy hauls. We get into movies a little bit. We get into comics. Mm-hmm. I'll be launching my own YouTube channel called Studio Tizzy in the next month or two. Right now I'm in the middle of putting together all the content, and yeah, you can find me on there and all those places.
Excellent stuff. Tim, where can people find more about you and your book project?
Facebook, A Real American Book. Instagram, A Real American Book. Best of all, arealamericanbook.com. Check the index, because the blog goes back 8 years.
And if you want to find out more about Talking Joe, the best place to go is talkingjoe.co.uk is our website, and that has got the links to the Facebook page, where we're always having interesting discussions, the Twitter page, Instagram, and the newly launched Patreon. So thanks to Jay, Sam, and Richard, our Patreon backers. They are able to receive some exclusive content as well as early access to all of the latest stuff. So I think that is us done. We will be back possibly in 2 weeks to talk about the next issue of ARAH, which will be 280. So bespectacled, beautiful and brilliant and bombastic, beware the Baroness bewitches in the final untold tale from living legend Larry Hama, alongside returning G.I. Joe artist Ron Joseph. But before then, we will be back talking Disavowed from Devil's Due, 2002, issues 14 and 15. When all said and done, you can catch us down the road.
Because we've been talking Joe.
And we're all out of Joes. But we could keep on talking forever, it feels like. Laters.
Bye, guys.
Thanks again, Alex.